So today we will be discussing about reference architecture of DDBMS. Before this, we need to know functions of DDBMS. Functions of DDBMS consist of extended communication services to provide access to remote sites and allow the transfer of queries and data among the sites using a network. Then another function is extended system catalog is there to store data distribution details. Next, distributed data processing includes query optimization and remote data access. And the fourth function is extended security control to maintain appropriate authorization, access, and privileges to distributed data. Next function, extended concurrency control to maintain consistency of distributed and possibly replicated possibly replicated extended concurrency control to maintain consistency of distributed and possibly replicated data, extended recovery services to take account of failure of individual sites and the failure of communication links. I hope functions are clear to you all. Next, we will be studying about reference architecture of DDBMS. Due to diversity in the nature, as DDBMS may consist of different DBMS at different sites, so we say there is no accepted architecture equivalent to ANSI or SPARC 3-level architecture, which we will be discussing about. So a reference architecture consists of a set of global external schemas, a global conceptual schema, fragmentation and allocation schema, a set of schemas for each local DBMS conforming to the ANSI SPARC 3-level architecture. So this is the overview of reference architecture. In this we are having different DB databases at the end, and at the topmost we are having site 1, site 2 up to site 10. These are global external schemas at that site, and then global external schema for site 2, then global external schema for site 3. These global external schema contribute towards global conceptual schema. From that we get fragmentation schema. Then allocation schema is there. Allocation schema allocates the data at different sites. It will be allocating the fragmented data at different sites. So in this case we can see at global schema there are multiple global schemas. They may be at different sites. They are combined into centralized global conceptual schema, then fragmentation schema, after that allocation schema is there. Now the global conceptual schema provides data to fragmentation schema. Fragmentation schema may convert data into different fragments. It may be horizontal or vertical fragments. After that, allocation schema provides the facility to allocate the fragmented data at different sites. It may be at site 1, site 2 or site 10. At different sites we are having local mapping schemas. Local mapping that maps the data at different conceptual schemas and local internal schemas. So these are the local schemas at different sites. So let us study a little bit in detail about global conceptual schema. So actually global conceptual schema is logical description of whole database as if it were not distributed. So it gives the assumption that data is not distributed. We can we can say the data is a single unit, means whatever data we need, we can get that. It contains definition of entities, relationships, constraints, security and integrity information. It provides physical data independence from the distributed environment. The global external schema provides logical data independence. So these are the basic views, which says global conceptual schema, logical description. It is according to ANSI SPARC architecture. All type of definitions are there. Physical data independence is provided, and global conceptual schema provides a logical data independence. Next we have fragmentation and allocation schema. So the fragmentation schema is a description of how the data is to be logically partitioned. It decides what type of fragmentation we need to create. It may be horizontal or vertical fragmentation, and whatever data is needed according to the selection and projection operations we discussed in the last lecture. So next it says the allocation schema is a description of where the data is to be located, taking into account any application. Whatever application has been required, it may be complete, it may be selective application, according to that it allocates the replicated copies, the fragmented data at different sites. Now next we have local schemas. Local schemas, here in local schemas, local conceptual and local internal schemas are there that are corresponding to ANSI SPARC architecture. Each local DBMS has its own set of schemas. The local mapping schema maps fragments in the allocation schema into external objects and in the local database. It is DBMS independent and is the basis for supporting heterogeneous DBMS. It means we need not to worry. The DBMS may be multimedia, it may be spatial, it may be temporal, but local schema is independent of all such types of DBMS because it provides heterogeneous DBMS. Then we have various components of DDBMS. So the component of DDBMS, major components are local DBMS, that is LDBMS component. Here we have local DBMS. After that we have DC, that stands for data communication. DDBMS consists of DC and LDBMS. Then we have global conceptual global schema system catalog. Global system catalog is there. Then we have DDBMS, that is actually distributed database management systems. So we have local DBMS component, that is LDBMS. The LDBMS component is a standard DBMS responsible for controlling the local data at each site that has a database. So its major task is controlling the data at all the sites. Each and every site has one its own LDBMS. It has its own local system catalog that stores information about the data held at the site. And if it is homogeneous, means all sites may store only RDBMS, or all sites may contain spatial data, all sites may contain multimedia database, but the condition is all the sites is having similar type of DBMS, so that is known as homogeneous system. So if we are having homogeneous system, the LDBMS component is the same product that is replicated at all the sites. But if we are having an heterogeneous system, then there would be at least two sites with different DBMS products or different platforms. The data communication component is the software that enables all the sites to communicate with each other. So this is the main component. If we want to access data at site 1, but the data is not present at site 1 and we need to fetch the data from site 3, site 3 consists of the replicated copy of the data, then we have to access the data with the help of data communication component. So in that case, data communication component ensures that whatever information we need will be transferred to the site that is demanding it. So DC component is the software that enables all the sites to communicate with each other. The DC component contains information about all the sites and the links. So here we say the data communication component must consist of information. It must contain the information that if data is needed at any site, then where the data is stored or where data is allocated. Suppose we want to access the data of mechanical engineering branch, then your DC component must know if the data is present at site 1, site 2, site 3, or if it is further partitioned, then it must contain all the information that where the various fragments are stored. Next, we have global system catalog. The global system catalog has the same functionality as the catalog of a centralized system. Means catalog is basically information provider which says what type of data is there, where it is there, where is it. So it has the same functionality as the centralized system. So the data global system catalog holds information specific to the distributed nature of the system, such as fragmentation, replication, allocation schemas. So it consists of all the fragments information and its allocation, its sites information. It can be managed as a distributed database, and so it can be fragmented and distributed fully or centralized like any other relation as we, any other information. Excuse me. A fully replicated global system catalog comprises site autonomy, as every modification to the global system catalog has to be communicated to all other sites. And the DC component And if we are having a centralized GSC, it also comprises site autonomy and it's vulnerable to failure of central site. So the problem with centralized is that if we have maintained it at a single site and that site goes down, then other sites will not be able to access the data because our global system catalog is not available. So we can't get information where the data is actually replicated. So a good idea is global system catalog should be maintained at n number of sites, 2 or more sites, so that it should be available whenever we need it. So the DDBMS component here in this case, distributed DBMS component, is the main controlling unit of the entire system. So that's all about our distributed DBMS component. In the next lecture, we will be discussing about concurrency control in DDBMS. So students, thank you. If you have any query, please ask in the comment box. Thank you.